good place to start is the statute. Take a look at the elements of the statute. Again, we're dealing with 2C3510A4. This is the definition that was given under the Comprehensive Drug Reform Act of 1987. So take a look at this, and let's break it down. It is unlawful for any person, knowingly or purposely, to obtain or to possess, actually or constructively, a controlled dangerous substance or controlled substance analog unless the substance was obtained directly or pursuant to a valid prescription or order form from a practitioner while acting in the course of his professional practice or except as otherwise authorized under, that's Title 24. Any person who violates this respect to, and here's the offense, okay, possession of 50 grams or less of marijuana, including any adulterants or dilutants of 5 grams or less of hashish, is a disorderly persons offense. Now, we have to talk about this, and I want to kind of talk about it in a little bit of reverse order. We talk about 50 grams of marijuana or less. That has some important meanings. Alan, if you have an individual, for example, who had just a seed of marijuana, one seed, okay, would that person technically be in violation of the statute?
Technically, yes, because they consider seeds to be part of the marijuana plant, and there is the decisions have basically said that there is no de minimis defense when it comes to controlled dangerous substances.
So kind of keep this in the back of your mind that I don't know that they've had a marijuana case on it for a seed, but they've certainly had it on other things, including very, very small trace amounts of cocaine, where people tried to get de minimis relief from the assignment judge in the Superior Court and were barred from doing it. Just as a matter of policy, there's a couple of petty offenses that you can't get de minimis treatment on, and this is one of them, any type of drug offense, no matter how small the amount of drug that you possess. Parenthetically, I'll tell you, the other kind that you get barred through the case law, this is from a decision written by Judge Karchman, is for shoplifting. For some reason, it doesn't matter that you that you shoplift something that is a de minimis amount that you shoplift. There is no relief for a de minimis treatment for that type of offense either.
Now, where you're talking about a simple seed, there may very well be proof problems that the state will have to overcome, but that's another issue.
Alan, would you agree with me that one of the critical pieces of evidence you need, especially if you're not legally in the United States, is a firm piece of evidence related to the amount of the marijuana that was recovered from you? Would you agree with that?
Absolutely.
And could you tell everybody why that's so important?
If you're not a citizen, whatever your status is in the United States, the possibility exists that you might want to become a citizen or removal proceedings might be filed against you. And the amount of marijuana involved is going to be important because the federal citizenship statutes and immigration statutes categorize the seriousness of your offense by the weight involved. Now, of course, in New Jersey, the cutoff weight between a disorderly persons and a crime is 50 grams, but under federal law, the cutoff is 30 grams. Am I right? 30 grams.
It is 30 grams.
30 grams. So what that means is that regardless of what else happens in the case, if your client is not a citizen, you're going to want to make sure that you get some kind of a lab certificate that spells out the quantity that is involved after the lab weighed it.
Remember that the complaint itself, the criminal complaint, is not going to know what the exact weight was. It'll just say under 50 grams. The affidavit of probable cause that the officer fills out if it's done on a warrant is not going to say it because the officer's not going to know. The only sure evidence you have is going to come from the New Jersey State Police Forensic Laboratories. So it's very important that for a certain class of client that you have them save this document. It becomes even more important if there's going to be an expungement of this later down the line, and for reasons which we'll tell you about in 1 second. I want you to think about the client base that would come into your office with a marijuana case and divide it into three groups, okay? You have people, first of all, who are U.S. citizens. And by that I mean they're natural-born people who born in the United States, have lived here all their lives. It doesn't matter where they lived here all their lives. They're just born here. They have birthright citizenship. You also have among the U.S. citizens people who are naturalized citizens. They've gone through whatever process it is to become an American citizen. When you have those individuals, there's no possibility of them being removed from the United States as a result of a marijuana conviction, no matter how much it is, okay? They may go to prison for the next 50 years, but they're not going to get kicked out of the country.
It'll be a United States prison.
That's right, unless they send them to Guantanamo. The second group of people I want you to think about are people who are not lawfully in the United States. They're just here because they came across the border, they're undocumented, or their visa ran out. I mean, for some reason, they're just not lawfully in the United States. Much less important with these individuals because whether they get removed from the United States is a question wholly apart from the issue on how the substantive charge they have is going to be resolved. They're going to be removed from the United States on a separate independent ground, that ground being they don't have the right to be in the United States in the first place. The main category of people I want you to think about that this is going to apply to are people who are lawfully in the United States but are not U.S. citizens. So, green card, you know, the permanent U.S. residents, student visa, work visa, you know, anything other than diplomatic status, okay? And there are individuals who fit that category who have been here for years, sometimes decades. They live here, work here, speak like you and I do with absolutely no accent, completely Americanized, have children who are U.S. citizens, they're married to U.S. citizens, they own property, they have jobs. And guess what happens when they get convicted of an offense involving possession of more than 30 grams of marijuana? They're subject to removal from the United States by ICE, okay? This is just one of those statutes that says that if you get convicted of this particular type of offense, you're subject to removal. And possession of marijuana over 30 grams is one of those offenses. Being a drug-addicted person, I guess that's what, theoretically, if you're addicted to marijuana, could also get you kicked out. We'll show you the statutes that say that. But I want to sensitize everybody to this. And it's probably a good practice if you're doing criminal law anyway, that when they come to see you, you ask them, what's your citizenship? Even if they sound like, you know, somebody from the Bronx, okay? What are you, a citizen of the United States or some other country, okay? Because that will trigger in your mind, if they're not U.S. citizens, you've got this additional consideration, okay? Now, so no de minimis treatment, the cutoff for federal removal proceedings, 30 grams. So far, so good? Now, one additional thing, and it deals with expungements and also petitions for citizenship down the line. You're the world's leading expert on expungements, right? Or one of them, anyway.
Well, I'm the leading expert probably in New Brunswick.
All right. Would you agree with me that if someone is going to get an expungement of his criminal record, it's probably a good idea for him to save information related to his criminal adventures? Let's say, for example, he got a conditional discharge and now he's going to get some type of expungement 6 months after the conditional discharge. Or he's pled out and 5 years has gone by and now he's eligible for an expungement. Would you think it's a good idea for that individual to save the laboratory report and all the information related to the transaction for his own personal records?
Absolutely, because once you get the expungement, the items that related to the case are no longer readily available. You can't go to police records and say, I need an arrest report. You can't go to the prosecutor and say, I need a lab report. You can't go to the court and say, I need a disposition report, because it's been expunged.
So the response you should get if it's gone through expungement properly is that there's no record found of this for this document. You're going to have to go to the Superior Court and get an order from the Superior Court for each one of these agencies you need a report from in order to have access to it. Very, very difficult, time-consuming, and unnecessary if you'll just take the steps initially before the expungement goes through to get copies of all the records that are related to this, police reports, anything you might possibly need, put it in a safe deposit box and leave it here. Now remember, the effect of an expungement, once it's granted, is going to be you're going to be able to lawfully deny that whatever had occurred didn't, you know, never happened, okay? However, there are certain times, and I can think of five of them, where you're going to have to reveal the fact that you had an expungement, okay? They would be employment with the judiciary, employment with law enforcement, employment with the Department of Corrections. If you're going to be applying for another conditional discharge, you know, another diversion, and also if you're going to get another expungement, okay? The ones that are going to hurt you, though, are seeking employment with judiciary corrections and law enforcement, because they're going to want to see, you know, you have to reveal the expungement. They're going to want to see the background associated with it, and you're going to have to show them exactly what happened, okay? Now, in the immigration context, this comes up as well. If your client at some point in the future is going to be making an application for to become a citizen or change his status from, you know, temporary to permanent resident alien or something of that nature, again, he's going to have to reveal this, the fact that this occurred, and you're going to want to show that it was marijuana and an amount under a particular level, certainly under 30 grams, and make sure that the last thing you want to show them is, you know, you just hope it's not cocaine, because that will definitely interfere with you.